It is so good to be with you guys. I was never more thrilled to land in Toronto this morning than anywhere in the world, and couldn't imagine the thought of missing this moment. Glad I got here early enough to be fed in my own soul by these dear brothers who have so faithfully preached the word. I love watching Robbie preach. I told him in the back room, John Wesley apparently had a statement, I keep it on my desk, God's word sets me on fire and people come to see me burn. If there was ever a preacher who I thought was going to blow up in a flame of glory while he's preaching, it's Robbie Simons, I tell you. honor to whom honor's due, I just want to make sure we all join together in saying what Robbie can't say, the staff can't say, and that is thank you to Robbie, the team here, these wonderful volunteers, the praise band. It's a lot of work to host all of us, and I know you want to join me in saying thank you, Lord, for this wonderful church, a treasured leader, and we appreciate all that you do for us. Amen. Amen. I always love, and I mentioned this last year, love being in harvest circles, because other than his influence on hearts, James McDonald's influence on hairlines has been very notable. I love that. That's why I love here, all you great heads. Now, I can't quite do the real harvest look. I got to keep a little, extra decor around there. I tried that once, and I looked like a Mini Cooper with the doors left open. You know, my ears were hanging out, and I was living in California at the time, and it didn't occur to me that I had this nice tan strip down the middle, and then once I shaved the sides, it was just white as can be, so I put a little of that tanner on there. I had three people ask me if I was on chemo. I said, this is not my look, so anyway, it is what it is, and we're grateful. Want to mention, I think we have a slide on this, I'm not sure, but I was supposed to get here yesterday and make these available to you. We brought a free CD for some of you guys. It's at the Welcome Center, and I'm not sure if that made it or not, but if you want to get that, I have a little hook. Every Monday, we send out an e-devotion, we call it. I should call it a blog, but I'm not cool. But it really is a devotion. It's not just a blog. It's some meat to start your week every Monday around renewal and purity and prayer and holiness, revival. And so there are some CD cards back there that you can get. And I thought we had a slide that gave you a way to text that in. I guess it didn't make it. But stop back there. And if you don't want to fill out the card, don't worry, because I don't want to carry him back with me. If it takes me three flights to get home like it did here, I just don't want an extra box. All right? So those are at the registration table. We'd be glad to share with you. It is called Prayer, the Family Connection. And I think it's a great takeaway. As you leave here and desire to be a man of prayer in your family and your marriage, it's just a practical message about how we can do that more effectively. And then I want to mention one last thing. On April 29th, which happens to be my birthday, we are doing a national, international webcast. And that is, I think we've got that one. Oh, there's that other slide. All right, better late than never. This is going to be called Old Paths, New Power. It's based on a book that Robbie's featured in. Robbie, you're going to do the webcast with me. I don't know if you know that, but we captured some interviews with you, with H.B. Charles, Paul David Tripp, a number of other people that'll be segmenting that. But if you really want to see your church awakened with a passion for prayer, a real desire for revival, pastors, I'd encourage you to check that out on our website, strategicrenewal.com, and we'd love to get you involved in an ongoing fueling of our passion for the glory of Christ. So having had those announcements, would you take your Bibles, turn with me today to Psalm 85. Psalm 85, and what a wonderful opportunity, and so humbled to do so, to culminate our time together as we have thought about the freedom that brings salvation, sanctification, that allows us to savor the gospel, and that, Lord willing, will enable us to truly experience a work of revival in our lives, our homes, our churches, our nations, and in the world. So as you're turning to Psalm 85, would you bow with me as we pray together? So, Father, we thank you again that in song, in word, in fellowship, and in prayer, we have truly been challenged to savor the great message and reality of Christ. And give your servant now a fresh lens of the gospel to look at this historic passage that calls us to your ideal for our lives, and that we individually and in every capacity of our journey at home, at work, at church, in the world, would be men whose lives are truly marked by the life and the fullness of Jesus Christ. And so we commit this to you now. For Christ's glory and the advancement of his mission, we pray. And all God's men said, amen, amen. Well, you would expect an American, and I didn't get to hear Vance, so I don't know if he said this, but to somehow make a note about the political season we're in south of the border right now. It's got ramifications all around the world as there are incredible debates on news, fake news, and otherwise, about what the greatest needs in our nation and even your nation perhaps are, whether it's national security, borders, stronger economy, jobs, affordable health care, racial relations. It goes on and on and on. Donald Trump has begun his quest to make America great again, for what it's worth. But I would tell you that as far as I'm concerned, the great need is not to make America great again or Canada great again. It's to make the church great again. Because America will only be great, Canada will only be great when the church is great. Again, by God's definition, a church of spiritual health and supernatural impact. And so I say it often, that the single greatest need in our nations today is Jesus Christ living through a revived church. Would you agree? In fact, that's going to be on my tombstone. I talk a lot about my tombstone. Someone told me one time, you're not ready to live until you know what you're written on your tombstone. So this is one of dozens of things I want on my tombstone. My kids are complaining all the time, Dad, we can't afford the tombstone. But I discovered something the other day. They now put QR codes on tombstones. Isn't that cool? You guys can go south of the border, visit me in Colorado, you know, pull out your phone and you can have them all. In fact, I figure by the time I die, we're going to have holograms. You just push a button and up I come. Hey, welcome today. Glad you stopped by. Pull out a pen and a paper. Let me tell you something, right? And one of those will be the single greatest need in our nation today is Jesus Christ living through a revived church. And I believe that with all my heart. That's why it'll be 10 years coming this summer. I stepped out of the security of pastoring a large church, and you know, most guys get to the top of the megachurch pile and ride into the sunset, and I jumped off the cliff without a parachute and said, we got to go for revival. If we don't have that, then we're just running laps on the Titanic and our fancy spandex. So it motivated me to do all I could to help pastors, to coach leaders, to encourage cultures of prayer so that we might indeed see Jesus Christ living through a revived church. And in so many ways, Rob referred to it, others, these are dark times. But I want to remind you, also a tombstone phrase, that the problem is not the pervasiveness of the darkness, but it's the failure of the light. Amen? And so when the church is truly radiant with the life and light of Jesus Christ, and his glory is dominating the daily reality of our journey, truly there is hope. So we're going to look at this psalm through a gospel lens, Psalm 85. Your Bible, perhaps like mine, titles this psalm, A Cry for Revival, or Revive Us Again. It is designed for the choir master, and it is a psalm from the sons of Korah. They were the worship leaders. So I would simply say, the truths of this psalm were designed to be a constant, reoccurring, passionate cry of the hearts of God's people. And it should be ours as well. Now, we don't know the exact context, but as I've studied this, believe that it really was after the children of Israel had come back from captivity under Babylon and Assyria. They had settled back after that miracle moment, and as so often happens, they had slipped back into apathy, and they were in need of another great touch from God. We need that as well. We need revival. Now, I don't know, we should clarify what revival is. I grew up, revival was a week of meetings. We would put an orange fluorescent banner out front, revival this week, June 23rd through 30th, need it or not. We'd bring in an evangelist. We'd all get saved again, baptized for the third time, and we'd call it revival. Some people today think revival is an event. You know, jumbotrons and celebrity speakers and singers, we get a quiver in our liver, we go home, and a week later, nothing's changed. We have all kinds of ideas. Everyone has a revival movement, and if you have to call it a movement, it probably isn't, right? And so revival, I think, needs some definition as we jump into this text. Now, there have been many of them. I love what Ian Murray says. He says, revival is an outpouring of the Holy Spirit brought about by the intercession of Christ, resulting in a new degree of life in the church. These are long definitions, aren't they? In widespread movement of grace among the unconverted. It's an extraordinary communication of the Spirit of God, a superabundance of the Spirit's operations, and enlargement of his manifest power. I like that. Simpler one, I like this one, Stephen Olford. This is my favorite. Revival is ultimately Christ himself seen, felt, heard, living, active, moving in and through his body on earth. And that is our need, isn't it? Now, I would simply say to you, though, that another tombstone phrase, there is a difference between seeking revival from God and seeking God for revival. There's a difference between seeking revival from God and seeking God for revival. Let me simply say it this way. It's the difference between seeking the gift versus the giver, the effect versus the cause, the product versus the source. And I would suggest to you, while we all are passionate about revival, it doesn't come from seeking revival. It comes from seeking Christ. It comes from a passionate, as we've heard throughout this conference, a passionate pursuit of him. So all this culmination of what you've heard today really is putting us at the place with a new desire for him and trusting him for the results. You see, I think our chances of revival would be much greater if we didn't care who got the credit for, right? I mean, let's just say revival came out of Oakville, or out of Toronto, or out of Hamilton, or wherever, and you know, it begins to spread across the country, which historically has happened. I'll tell you about that in a minute. But let's say 10 years from now, the revival subsides. The question is, would we still be praying with the same passion as we were before the revival? You see, this again is about the worthiness of Christ. It's not about the effect. Revival is a sovereign move of God. We can't create the wind, but as I often say, we can certainly set our sails to catch it when it blows. And that is our desire when we talk about revival. Many people south of the border, I think, believe that when revival comes, you may not understand this, I wish I knew the equivalent, we all go back to Mayberry. In other words, in the United States, we're all going to go back to the 50s. Everybody sits on the front porch, drinks iced tea. You know, everybody's a Republican, all is well. And I think that's what many people think about revival. I want to tell you something. If revival comes, it may get worse before it gets better. Because you talk about the church getting in the face of a sinful culture. Watch out. When we are revived, it ain't going to be well received. But here's the point. Jesus is not concerned about the size of his church. He's concerned about the strength of his church. And the issue of revival is not that we have better productions or more clever personalities or programs. It's that we are a pure church. I, again, have been in China recently, and if you've been in places like that where they're under persecution, the great revivals of our time are occurring where there is a hostile environment. And that is just part of God's way of making his own power great. And so today we look at this amazing opportunity in Psalms to learn more about this thing of revival, and I trust it'll be a great encouragement to you. Now, again, through a gospel lens, let me say this. There will be reference to the land. It's not about land now. We don't take territory for Jesus anymore. Our goal is that the Holy Spirit will take territory in us, right? And so this is not about physicality and property and dirt. This is about human hearts and the amazing advancement of the gospel of Christ. So we're going to see four things today. And we're going to spend most of our time on the first one, so don't get impatient, all right? I think it'll be a great encouragement to you. I want you to see, as we just walk through Psalm 85 now, what a true pursuit of God for revival looks like. Again, what it looks like to pursue God for revival. First of all, as we pick up in verses 1 through 3, it involves a grateful remembrance of God's past work, okay? A grateful remembrance of God's past work. I remember hearing a man tell me in seminary something I never got over. Some pastoral students were in a meeting with him, and one of them asked him, what's the key to knowing God's will? And I thought he was going to use the standard things, you know, the Word of God, which is obviously true, prayer, peace, wise counsel, etc. He said something that has marked me ever since. He said, the key to knowing God's will is to learn to trust your great moments. Learn to trust your great moments. And I'm reading through the scripture again this year and how many times God told the children of Israel to memorialize these moments when he was at work in their lives. I would suggest to you that's why we have communion on a regular basis. We are coming back to trust the great moment of our salvation. That's why I started journaling, because I forget my great moments. And practical takeaway, guys, before this weekend's over, I hope you'll find time to take that journal you got and write down everything God taught you, circle the things that have stood out to your heart, and pull it out a week from now, a month from now, 3 months from now, and trust those great moments, because God works in our lives so that we can look back to rejoice in his power and move forward standing in that same trust and confidence for the present day. Amen? So here's what really is being said. Pick up with me verses 1, 2, and 3. They are all past tense. You'll notice it's, Lord, were you not favorable to your land? You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people. You covered all their sin, Selah. You withdrew all your wrath, and you turned from your hot anger. So let's cut to the chase. Four things about God's past work are being seen in their context, which are very real for all of us, and that is God's favor, his restoration, his forgiveness, and his mercy. God's favor, we also call it God's grace, right? God giving us what we don't deserve. God's restoration, taking those things that are useless and broken and giving them new usefulness for him. Forgiveness, taking away our sin and making us clean. Mercy, not judging us over the things that we deserve, but extending mercy. Aren't you grateful for all those? What has God done in your life to just lavish you with his grace? How has he restored you? In fact, do this. You don't need to talk to me. Turn to someone next to you. What has God restored in your life? And not your old car. I'm not talking about that. All right? I'm talking about you. Just turn to someone. Tell them, God has restored. Go ahead. That, you can talk to each other. It's all right. I'll bring you back in a minute. What has God restored in your life? Your marriage, your joy, your sobriety. We could go on and on and on. And the psalmist is basically saying, God, we look back and we've seen what you've done. You have given us such grace, such restoration, forgiveness, and mercy. And all this is a reflection of his unchanging character. And in a sense, we look back to the cross ultimately, and we trust the great moment of what Jesus has done in our lives. Now, I'm going to do something highly unusual, because as a body of Christ, as modern day believers, we need to corporately be able to do this same thing. Look back at God's grace, look back at his restoration, look back at his forgiveness, look back at his favor. And by and large, I think many of us don't realize how God has done this very work in our history. So I'm going to give you a quick overview of what we call the Great Awakenings, because I want you to leave here with hope, brothers. I want you to know, look at what God has done, so that we have an incredible belief in what he can do and what he will do. Many of you are familiar with what we call the First Great Awakening. It, again, occurred south of the border, but it affected many of the nations of the world in the 1730s and 40s. You would recognize men like Edwards and Whitfield, who Robbie mentioned earlier. During that awakening, the number of people in the church, believers, wasn't just added, it was multiplied. Christian piety was evident in God's people. Denominational barriers broke down. That's what I love about the upcoming Vertical Conference. Denominational barriers broke down. They began to work together for the cause of the gospel. There was a renewed concern for missions, reaching the First Nations people with the gospel, a concern for higher education, Christian education. So those great bastions of conservative theology like Princeton, Rutgers, Brown, and Dartmouth, if you're an American, you know that was sarcasm, right? But they were founded as Christian universities. And so there's this incredible movement. Some would even say in the United States that it was this newfound spiritual freedom that led to the American Revolution, a desire for societal freedom as well and religious freedom. So that was the first great awakening. Now, people ask, how often do we need a revival? I would say basically once a generation. In Judges, it says of the Jewish people, there arose another generation after them who knew not the Lord, neither did they know his works. And indeed, every generation needs a revival of a knowledge of Christ and a remembrance of his works. And then that led us to what we call the Second Great Awakening in the early 1800s. Again, the nation in America was in decline. It happened in other places as well, and very much mirrored, I think, in both of our countries. For example, in the United States, out of a population of 5 million, 300,000 were confirmed alcoholics. They were bearing 15,000 a year. Women were afraid to go out at night for sake of being assaulted. Bank robberies were a daily occurrence, and the churches were in rapid decline. In fact, in the United States, the Chief Justice, his name was John Marshall, wrote to James Madison that the church was too far gone to ever be redeemed. And Voltaire was saying that Christianity would be forgotten in 30 years. Harvard, which was founded to train Puritan ministers, had discovered there wasn't one Christian left on campus. At Princeton, they found two. A place called Williams College was holding mock communions to denigrate Christianity. Another university, anti-Christian plays. Christians were so few on one campus that they held secret meetings and kept their notes in code just so they wouldn't be found out. Another university, New Jersey, burned a Bible out of a local Presbyterian church in a public square. And I say that because sometimes we look around and we think it's never been this bad before. But brothers and sisters, the power of God and the gospel at work in God's people can turn things around like that. What happened in that time, basically, that God began to move. Half of the student body at Yale University came to Christ. Christians became leaders in social concerns of education, social reform, temperance, women's rights. It was called the Benevolent Empire. And the Second Great Awakening resulted in all kinds of missionary institutions, Sunday school institutions, etc. But here's one I want you to hear about. Again, about a generation later, about the 1850s, 1857, there was a panic that occurred in New York, a financial panic that lasted several years. And during that time, there was a guy named Jeremiah Lamphere, just like some of you, who had been a layman. He was feeling a call to ministry, and he had a burden to begin to call the men together to pray. So in a population of 1 million people, he put the word out, and finally they had their noontime prayer meeting, and six guys showed up. Half of them were late. The next week, there were 14. The next week, there were 23. Soon, every day, they were praying. And by late winter, every public hall in New York was filled with men praying. You'll love this caveat. There was a man named Horace Greeley who owned a paper. He sent one of his reporters around at the noon hour to see how many men were praying. He only got to 12 prayer meetings and discovered there were 6,100 men at those 12 prayer meetings. God was on the move through men just like you who had a burden to see Christ exalted in their community. Pretty soon it spilled over into the churches. Every night they were having prayer meetings in the churches to the point that 10,000 people a week were getting saved in New York alone. It spread into New England. Even the Baptists had revival. I'm Baptist. They were going down to the river, cutting a hole in the ice, and baptizing people in frozen water. And when the Baptists do that, you know it's revival, right? But here's what you'll love. There are some historians who believe that that revival actually started in Hamilton, Ontario. There was a retired dentist, a physician rather, and his wife who began to hold prayer meetings and preach among the Methodist churches in Hamilton to the point that hundreds were converted in a period of a few weeks, including the mayor. And one historian says, out of that thing in Hamilton, coupled with the panic in New York, there was this incredible movement of the Spirit of God that ultimately led to the start of the Civil War. It was during that same time that this great awakening began to spill into other areas and other countries of the world. Listen to this. I know it sounds like history, but guys, we got to know this so that as we look back to the great moments, we believe God can do it again. Within a year, Andrew Murray championed, some of you would know that name, a revival in South Africa. Within 3 years, Charles Spurgeon built the first megachurch in history, the Metropolitan Tabernacle, in 1861. Abraham Lincoln, 4 years later, issued the Emancipation Proclamation. 6 years later, Hudson Taylor began China Inland Mission. 8 years later, some people called William and Catherine Booth started the Salvation Army. George Mueller built his last orphanage in 1870. About 10 years later, D.L. Moody came to prominence after the Chicago Fire. Under D.L. Moody, there was a guy named Wilbur Chapman who came to Christ. Chapman recruited an assistant named Billy Sunday, who then recruited a guy named Mordecai Ham, under whose preaching Billy Graham got saved. Friends, I want to tell you, when God works in an amazing way, it affects the nations of the world. Amen? Amen. So I would just suggest to you, as J.I. Packer said, God revives his church, and then the new life overflows from the church for the conversion of outsiders and the renovation of society. Here's the point. During that revival, started by guys just like you, it's an amazing statistic, but it's one that is so true. It's been said that during that time, there were indeed 1 million people saved in 1 year in a population of 30 million. That would be tantamount to 10.5 million in America. Again, millions here in Canada. Imagine what God can do. Now, I got to tell you about one more, and then we'll go on. I told you this could be a history lesson, right? This stuff encourages me. This gets me all jazzed up. There was a generation later, about 1905, the Welsh Revival started in Wales. It was so powerful that the judges in Wales were presented with white gloves. They had no cases to try. The district councils held emergency meetings in some of the areas wondering, what do we do with the police now that they were basically unemployed? A reporter went to a police station, asked him, what do you do with your time now? And they said, well, before the revival, we had two jobs, prevent crime and control the crowds. They basically said, well, what are you doing now? Well, there's really not much crime, and so we go where the crowds are. You know, that's where the churches are gathering and having revival. And he says, well, what does that mean? He said, well, in our case, we have 17 policemen, we have 4 quartets, and if any of the revivals need a quartet, they call the police department and we come and sing for them. Isn't that awesome? This is not fantasy. A guy named J. Edwin Orr has documented all this with great insight. In fact, in Wales, the mines even slowed down, and I'll tell you why. Because so many miners got saved, they cleaned up their language, and the horses couldn't understand their commands anymore. They had to be retrained. God can do this. Look back. Remember the great moments of our lives. In North America, Atlantic City, they had a population of 15,000, could only find 50 people that had not been converted. And I love this story, and I'll wrap up with this. In Portland, Oregon, 240 major stores had a covenant with one another to close their doors from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. every day so that people could attend the prayer meetings. Isn't that awesome? So this psalm begins, Lord, look at the favor. Look at the restoration. Look at the forgiveness. Look at the mercy. And that's what we must do. We could mention the Saskatoon revival, the Jesus movement. But I will tell you this, all of these revivals were marked by extraordinary prayer and passionate preaching of the Word of God. That's why Robbie and I and a lot of us, we just emphasize Acts 6:4, and we have a fellowship of pastors that just let's continue to focus on prayer and the ministry of the word. And I would tell you, in status quo Christianity, we pray in the context of ministry. During revival, we minister in the context of prayer. And indeed, God wants to stir that in our hearts, all right? Now, secondly, this seeking God for revival involves a humble admission of our present need. A humble admission of our present need. It's one thing to look back and be excited about what God did. Now we've got to stop and say, where are we, Lord? Pick up with me in verse 4. The psalmist now says, restore us, Lord. Literally, bring us back, turn us back. Restore us, O God of our salvation. Put away your indignation toward us. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger to all generations? Stop right there. Gospel lens, aren't you glad that we are no longer objects of the wrath of God? Jesus was our propitiation. He satisfied God's wrath against our sin. But for us, it is really a cry, Lord, let us live in the fullness of this salvation. Let us not take for granted what you have done to remove your wrath. Let us live in rich, intimate fellowship with you. Verse 6, will you not revive us? Let us live again that your people may rejoice in you. The you there is emphatic. Literally, it would read this way. Will you not revive us again? God, do what only you can do in our hearts. This is a prayer we know that you can answer. It's a work only you can accomplish. It's a hope you want us to embrace. So verse 7, Lord, show us your steadfast love. Think Jesus, right? Oh, Lord, grant us your salvation. Think Christ. Lord, let us hear what God will speak. Think of his word, his spirit living in us. For he will speak peace to his people, to his saints, but let them not return back to folly. This is really the psalmist saying, this is what we need again. We need the fullness of your salvation that will be near to us as we fear you, that your glory will dwell in our land. So it's a revival of life, of love, of God's saving power, of peace, the things that only he can do. So let's pause. Do we need this revival? Absolutely. I have a friend, John Dickerson. Robbie knows him. We were together at a conference this past fall. And he wrote a book called The Great Evangelical Recession. I won't give you the totality of it, but four things he said that I think were so riveting. He has all kinds of documentation to back it up. He basically says of the North American church, number one, we are smaller than we think we are. We are smaller than we think we are. That when you really, from a biblical standpoint, define what a Christian is, a real evangelical Christian who believes in the Word of God, has embraced the gospel, has been transformed by grace, is committed to their church, is serving by the power of the Spirit, Dickerson says it's less than 10%. Secondly, he points out that we are failing to disciple the next generation. And this, again, is why we need revival. He notes that the millennials, many of whom, who grew up in the church, 6 in 10 have dropped out at some point. And I'm sure those statistics are very similar among our countries. That 3 in 10 millennials and another 4 in 10 basically are ambivalent about the church. And they are now being discipled by the leading segments of society that have an anti-Christian bias. You understand that, right? Whether it is media, whether it is Silicon Valley, the government, higher academics, etc. And so he points out that, again, not only are we smaller than we think we are failing to disciple the next generation, and our cry should be, oh God, revive us again. The third thing he points out very briefly, that we're facing hostility from powerful forces in the broader culture. We are facing hostility from powerful forces in the broader culture. Nicholas Kristof writes for the New York Times. He's a renowned writer. He's not a Christian. But he said in one of his articles, he said, in liberal circles, evangelicals constitute one of the few groups that it is safe to mock openly. And I believe we see the symptoms in both of our countries in terms of the trends that are increasingly becoming very open about their criticism of Christianity. I have a friend on my board. He's a political consultant. And he leaned across the table to me the other day and he said, Daniel, do you realize that your grandchildren, of whom there are 8, just had one born last week. My oldest son finally had the sense to name one of his boys Daniel. So there's another Daniel Henderson in the world. Lord help us. Anyway, he leaned across the table to me. He said, Daniel, do you realize that your grandchildren are the first generation to be born for whom being a good citizen and being a good Christian will not be the same thing? I didn't forget that. I mean, that's where we're headed. Brothers, apart from a revival, there is no political candidate, there is no system, there is no human effort that's going to stop the tide of the spiritual decline, and we need revival. One Christian leader from China said it this way, Christians in China are praying for our Christian brothers and sisters in America. We believe we are handling our persecution better than you're handling your prosperity. And I think we would all have to say, yes, Lord, help us. The last thing that he mentions is that some large ministries will begin to struggle financially because most of their donations are coming from the oldest 2 generations, right? What I love about this conference is all the young men who are coming to faith, and that is our hope. But the reality is, apart from a revival, he estimates that many of the large Christian ministries throughout North America are going to see their income cut by 50%. Now, again, we could go on and on, but brothers, that's a wake-up call. We can't just coast. We can't just go to church and do the same old, same old. We need to have the heart of this psalmist and look back and say, God, you've done it before. Look at your mercy, your grace, your forgiveness. Look at your restoration. And God, we need it again. We look to you. We cry out. And then I want you to pick up with me as we just move quickly at verse 10. And I want you to see we also then must have a Godward anticipation of our future hope. A Godward anticipation of our future hope. Because now the psalmist goes future tense. He begins to look at what could happen. And I love the imagery he uses. And again, guys, through a gospel lens, think Jesus. He says, steadfast love and faithfulness meet. Who is the personification of that? Our Lord Jesus Christ. The steadfast love of God, the faithfulness of God meet. Then he says, righteousness and peace kiss each other. Right living and the peace of God have this convergence of beauty and life in the hearts of God's people. Again, that's Jesus. And then he says, faithfulness springs up from the ground. The only way we know to describe it is faithfulness is everywhere, and righteousness is above us. Right living, right thinking, right relationships is in the environment. Verse 12. Yes, the Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Again, it's not about land. God will give what is good, and his people will indeed be fruitful in the mission to which he has left them. It's not about land having increase. It's about the church having increase, people coming to faith, people being disciples, families being transformed. Yes, the Lord will give what is good. Verse 13, and righteousness will go before him. The pathway of the righteousness of Jesus Christ will make a footsteps for us all. That, my brothers, is revival. And that ought to be our desire. Again, Jesus Christ, living, moving, felt, heard, seen among his people. And finally, I want us to see one last thing. You say, you're finished with the psalm. Where'd you get this last point? This is key right here. All right? I'm not adding to the scripture. We're circling back just so you're not nervous, all right? But the last thought about seeking God for revival is it involves a holy passion for God's ultimate purposes. So you may not have noticed, I didn't touch on it. Some of you wonder, why didn't you hit on that? Well, here's the answer. There are two verses where we see a purpose clause. And in the English, the key word is that, right? Will you not do this, that, in order that? And I want you to see it, first of all, in verse 6. Will you not revive us again, what? That your people may rejoice in you. And here it is. God's passion is that we would find joy and satisfaction in him alone. You've heard it preached. Savoring the gospel, savoring Christ, savoring our salvation, savoring our sanctification. You'd think we all work for the same boss, wouldn't you? It all comes together in this point that God's people will find joy and satisfaction in Christ alone. That's revival. That's revival. Now, here's the kicker, the flip side of the coin. And you've already heard this too. When that is not the case, what are we guilty of? When our joy and satisfaction is not in him, what's the problem? It's idolatry, isn't it? It's other things holding the affection, the joy, and the satisfaction of our heart. Tim Keller describes idolatry in this way. Listen, guys. He says, idolatry is anything more important to you than Christ. Anything that absorbs your heart, imagination more than God. Anything you seek to give you what only he can give. And I love the way he describes this. He says, whatever you look at and say in your heart of hearts, if I have that, then I'll feel my life has meaning. Then I'll know I have value. I'll feel significant and secure. He says, that is an idol. And not knowing what Robbie was going to say last hour, Keller says it this way, the best way to describe this idolatry is worship. And you mentioned Matt Papa, who said, we worship our way into idolatry and we worship our way out of idolatry. Tozer said it this way, an idol of the mind is as offensive to God as an idol of the hand. And I would simply say it this way, there are idols that we have in our possession, but there are also idols that we cultivate in our passions. And so today, brothers, if this is going to be revival, we don't need events and jumbotrons, and we don't need all the things that we create. God can use all of that, but it all begins right here. Will you not revive us again that your people will rejoice in you? There's a second purpose. Look at verse 9. And here it is. That glory may dwell in our land. Here's the point. That his glory would be preeminent in our lives and our churches. A passion for the glory of Jesus Christ. Now again, the word glory is one we hear a lot about. Sometimes we don't understand what it means. I'll just quickly give you my definition. It is simply this. It is the magnification of the person of Christ by his people, and it is the manifestation of the presence of Christ in and through his people. That's why the passage from Colossians talked about heaven being glory. Why? Because glory is Jesus. It's Jesus in his fullness, the fullness of worship, the fullness of his life now, being all that we are and all that we have for all of eternity in worship. And so this is the idea that our singular concern is his glory in our lives. Paul said it this way, and I love it. Philippians 1, 20 and 21, he said, my eager expectation and hope is that I will not be ashamed about anything, but now, as always, with all boldness, Christ will be highly honored in my body, whether by death or by life. Now, Paul wasn't writing that in his easy chair, thinking of someday being in a, you know, a nursing home and finally kicking the bucket. Paul wrote that realizing today could be the day that my head goes off. And it doesn't matter whether I live or whether I die. All that I care about is the glory of Christ in my life, that he will be highly honored in everything I am, everything I do, everything I say. But speaking of tombstones, I do have now in my life one verse. If I can only do one thing, if the hologram's busted and the QR code doesn't work, stop by and you will see this. Because this is a verse that has so gripped my heart, and Paul said it this way as he described his ministry in Galatians 1:24. They glorified God because of me. Say that with me. They glorify God because of me. That's the mark of a revived man. Will you not revive us, Lord, that there will be no idols, no competitors, but the joy and satisfaction of our heart will be in Christ. And will you not revive us again so that everyone who encounters my life will glorify you because of me, that your glory may be paramount in everything that I do. So in just a moment, we're going to seal what has happened here as we pray together. I want to ask you two simple questions. Ask you to ask yourself these questions. What are the idols of my life? What are the idols of my life? And so instead of me telling you, you know, the Bible says confess your faults one to another. Now, you don't need to confess your idolatry, but maybe the guy next to you, you know what his are. But let's just, in this final moment, let's just be honest, guys. What are the idols of our lives? I'm going to ask some of you just to declare it out because, you know, the devil loves things kept in darkness, doesn't he? But when we expose them to the light, and when we do it in community, and it becomes a target of our prayers, there's a breakthrough there. So it may have been something you've already heard last night, today. Maybe something you found out about a dude at lunch, you know? Might even be one of your own. But what are our idols? I want you to just to say it out loud, any of them. Wow, what was that?
Entertainment,
we heard that. What else? Okay, yeah, it could be our family, our household. What else?
Career?
Internet? Email?
Recognition?
Boy, we've gone to meddling now already. What else? Going to the gym, our body. What was this one?
Self.
Pride. Work. Future retirement.
Phone, money.
Yeah, it is. It's where we invest our money, where we invest our time, our attention, our energy.
Reputation.
What was that one?
Recitation?
Oh, yeah, reputation. Hearing aids, that'd be one of them. Yeah. I mean, guys, today.
Success.
Yeah. Pleasure. Toupee, I don't know, what else would it be? Lots of them, right? But in all seriousness, guys, revival begins when our own hearts, we say, Lord, anything that is the object of my joy and satisfaction other than Christ is an idol. And today I want to confess that to you. And I want to ask you for the grace that you will be the joy of my heart. I'm reading, as I said, through the Bible, and it astounded me last week. These chapters in Exodus, like 26 through 31, all this instruction about the tabernacle and all the gold and the beauty and excellence of it all, and Aaron the high priest and his garb and his sons and having a bell on his robe so that if he dies in the holiness of God, they'll know and they can pull him out. Think about this imagery of the holiness of God. And days later, Moses on the mountain and Aaron caves in. They all build a golden calf. And I thought to myself, you know, we're here, we're now, but it's not going to be long before it creeps back in again. And we have to be resolved. There will be no other gods before him. And then, Lord, who is it that I want to glorify you because of me? So as the band comes and begins just to play quietly, men, here's how we're going to end. I'm going to guide you in some very specific prayer response out of this text. And I'm going to ask you to stand, and as the band plays, find five or six guys. Now, let me say something before you stand. You don't have to pray out loud, all right? That may not be your deal. If your whole group is introverts, listen to the group next to you pray and confess. It'll be a blessing to you, all right? You don't have to pray out loud. But you know, we need to hear each other, don't we? And some of us, this will be your way of really sealing what God has done in your life. And so I want us today, by the grace of Christ, to say, Lord, will you not revive us again? And I want us to truly ask him to be the joy and rejoicing of our heart in these coming days and hours. And ask that he will be the that his glory will be the incredible, surpassing passion of everything we are and everything we do.